We'll go ahead and get started.
Yeah.
Over the last few years, it's become very apparent that something we always took for granted in the ICU, that is sleep, is actually a major contributor to a lot of the issues we have in the ICU, ICU psychosis, which we now know is dementia, or delirium, sorry. Sorry, B. Is ICU delirium, and probably PTSD from the ICU also. All seem to be related, at least in part, to the fact that nobody sleeps in the ICU. Well, when we started thinking about this, I realized, at least I know absolutely nothing about sleep. So Dr. Chernyshev has been very kind to come down here and actually introduce us to what's known about sleep now. I mean, because I, quite honestly, the only thing I know about it is I need it.
Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Chernyshev, and it's a privilege to give you grand rounds. And this specific topic is quite new for sleep medicine field. And I would say that sleep medicine field is still young field. And we exploring a lot of interesting things, especially overlapping with other subspecialties and other specialties related to sleep. And what is interesting, I think we should start thinking not only about vertical translational research, but also horizontal translational research, so making sure that fields which or subspecialties which exist also learn from each other and then communicate with each other, overlap with each other. So, no financial conflicts in my talk. I will try to keep the pace and move forward with the goal of finishing by 1, and maybe earlier. So, David McCarthy, I would like to give thank you to my mentor and teacher, and I think true leader in clinical sleep medicine. Goals of our presentation would be as listed. So we want to improve quality and quantity of sleep in patients who are hospitalized with critical illness, intensive care unit, decrease morbidity and length of stay for such patients, encourage multidisciplinary discussion about sleep-related issues in hospitalized patients, enhance the academic standing of Division of Sleep Medicine, making sure that you ask us for help if you feel that patient needs for sleep related issues should be addressed. Objectives, we'll discuss various normal physiologic changes which occur during sleep, discuss physiologic psychological consequences of sleep deprivation, learn about five-finger approach to explore sources of sleep disruption in ICU, apply this tool, I would say universal tool, which help you quickly understand and cut through the issues with your patients in any setting, but specifically we'll apply it for ICU. Describe practical strategies to minimize the impact sources of sleep disruption in the ICU. Not talk about delirium ICU, but we'll talk about those things which can potentially help you to prevent it. So, sleep is vital to normal physiology, and ICU patients are often sleep deprived. While they stay in unit, the first step for understanding it, we need to recognize the problem. And obviously, team-oriented approach will be necessary to change team-based system. We will talk about basic structure, mechanism, physiology, changes of sleep, adverse effects of sleep deprivation, again, five-finger approach, and we will learn how to use it in regular practice in ICU, and we'll do a summary. So what is sleep? The definitions of sleep are different, and one of them is it's reversible behavioral state, perceptual disengagement from environment, which accompanied by unresponsiveness. That's what we see, and we see patient or person who is sleeping has closed eyes, has a specific posture, could be lateral, could be a supine position, and but it will assume all unresponsiveness, so you technically will see somebody completely detached from environment. So changes in perception about sleep. We need to remember that we live in social society which has human beings, and when human beings come together, they create a culture. So one of those famous sayings from Shakespeare tells us, "Honey, have it your slumber," very famous. But here we have Thomas Edison, who after inventing this important electrical tool, which we electricity and electrical bulb gave us light, he thought and that time that sleep is a criminal waste of time. And I think our culture inherited that, bringing to life those things. And we see somebody sleepy and tired, we start putting labels for these patients, for these people, you know, like lazy people, you know, not paying attention, and don't want to learn, no motivation. So those things need to be addressed and understood. And obviously, if you go to, let's say, South America, when it's okay to have post-lunch nap, right, siesta, when sleep is treated differently, so sleep is embraced, rest is embraced, it's a different story. So please be aware of those cultural things. Obviously, everybody knows Dr. Halsted, and his famous operations and descriptions of those operations and lifestyle were associated with use of those substances, which we know, and the exploration of those substances, which actually came along with times, right? When I was reading the statement from Coca-Cola company that in 1909, they stopped putting cocaine into the Coca-Cola. So obviously now we know why Coca-Cola is so famous in the market and have drawn such admiration, right? But became part of the culture, right? And since 1909, when prohibition started, they eliminated that cocaine from Coca-Cola. So now what we have available on the market still used with they replaced it with caffeine. Now caffeine is still present in some of those recipes. So why do we sleep? Important features of sleep and important necessary. So sleep is necessary for energy conservation, brain processing, specifically memory consolidation, non-REM sleep, novel solution to complex problems, which translate to creativity. Next day REM sleep was notorious for that, and if you read literature, that's what they would say. And also restoration of brain function through metabolic waste removal. So let's quickly review this two-process model of sleep. That way it will help you understand what we're talking about. So rule number one, being alive, awake, and metabolically active makes a person sleepy in proportion to amount of time spent awake. So we call it sleep pressure or process S. Okay. So the more you stay active, the more sleep pressure you build in your brain. So brain is wired to promote stabilization of wakefulness despite sleep pressure. So something needs to counteract sleep pressure to keep you awake, alert, and be able to function and perform your behavioral duties. So rule three, an optimum opportunity for sleep exists due to scheduled downtime of wake promotion concomitant with scheduled sleep promotion. So circadian rhythm or process S. So in other words, your activity needs to be aligned with external clock. So your internal clock needs to be aligned with external clock to make sure that it will be appropriate time to get up, appropriate time to go to sleep according to your adaptation in environment. So how they play out, there is very famous graph. So processes described here, sleep pressure which builds up throughout, you see that 9 a.m. day active 9 p.m. So you see sleep pressure building up throughout the day and reaches around 9 p.m. Let's, you know, assume that patient is has daytime alignment for alertness and wakefulness and nighttime for sleep. So you see by evening time, our sleep pressure reaches the highest point and alerting signals, process S, they also counteract this and finally give up around this point, let's say 9 p.m. During that sleep time, sleep pressure is deflating and we see that alerting signals also go away, promoting sleep, and in the morning everything starts back again. So alertness level fluctuates throughout 24-hour period. This is a take-home message from this slide. So other way to put it together, so process S is awake and metabolism dependent. So when we wake up in the morning, during daytime activities, sleep pressure is built. So what substances, what specifically neurotransmitters responsible for building up the sleep pressure? We have substances, and one of the famous one which is responsible for sleep pressure is adenosine. Adenosine, interleukin-6, interleukin-1, tumor necrosis factor alpha, prostaglandin D2. And what is good about adenosine, that our famous caffeinated beverages are a very close formula with adenosine, and what caffeinated beverages doing, and caffeine specifically, it blocks adenosine receptors. And by blocking adenosine receptor, it extends our wakefulness. You might achieve successful extension of wakefulness with this compound by about 2 hours per 24-hour period. After that, it drops and it will not help alertness at all because adenosine will overcome, build up of adenosine will overcome that effect. So process C, it's also dependent on a lot of things. What you have here, this is reticular formation, reticular activating system, which helps our brain to function. And different neurotransmitters are responsible for sustaining our alertness through reticular formation. Two pathways described, dorsal pathway and ventral pathway. But what is important here that hypocretin stabilizes sleep and posterior hypothalamus. Histamine, tubular mammary nucleus, also alerting agent. Acetylcholine, dopamine, norepinephrine also help to sustain our wakefulness through reticular formation. One place, sleep promoting place called VLPO, ventrolateral preoptic nucleus, is a sleep promoting structure in the hypothalamus, anterior hypothalamus, which can shut down all this activating a system efforts to sustain our alertness. So it stays on the front and can pretty much through these connections can stop it. Okay, and it becomes part of the or forms sleep-wake switch. Okay, so VLPO will be the ventrolateral preoptic area through GABA mechanisms will shut down all reticular activating system and tuberally mammary nucleus with histamine, okay, will be able to overcome that and switch to the turn switch on when it's necessary. And obviously, one more thing we need to understand here: we now know how we become sleepy, right? So adenosine builds up, and a lot of neuroinflammatory and inflammatory substances build up and puts us asleep. But what happens during sleep time? Why we have this refreshing restoration effect of the sleep? So recently, it was discovery made. So-called glymphatic system discovery. And the set of experiment was made in mouse and animals, show that CSF from subarachnoid space enters the brain along paravascular channels surrounding penetrating arteries. So this is artery, this is vein, this is blood-brain barrier, this is aquaporin 4. Pores, so CSF exchanges with brain interstitial fluid through aquaporin 4, localized along this astrocytic and feet, and convective bulk fluid flux allows efflux to paravascular spaces surrounding the large caliber draining veins. So in other words, all this interstitial space gets kind of swollen during sleep time, to provide only one thing, drainage, improve drainage through the through this glymphatic system. So, and that facilitates clearance of interstitial solutes from the brain, and drainage happen through the veins and bringing them back to the heart and assumes important role. So I will just briefly show you that experiment. So it was a set of tracers. One was used during sleep, green one, and it penetrated throughout interstitial spaces. And when during wake, they introduced different colored tracer, it did not penetrate at all. It did not penetrate. So you see this orange one, it did not go through interstitium during wake time. But the green one, when animal was sleeping, it just penetrated through the whole interstitial space, reflecting that increase in volume of CNS in the extracellular space. Also, one more set experiment showed also this process and phenomenon. In other words, during sleep, it was better drainage coming through the blood-brain barrier and the interstitial spaces. Also, in the Science, actually, in 2013, it was a famous article which showed that beta amyloid clearance happens through glymphatic system. So that brought this conclusion to life, saying that our sleep is providing us a biological cleaning service. Whatever we accumulate during daytime, adenosine, amyloid, maybe synuclein, maybe other pathologic proteins which are responsible for neurodegeneration, they all go and get eliminated during sleep time. So, well, the purpose of sleep, restorative function, and the clearance of degenerative products was established. So that's why we sleep. We sleep to clean the brain, okay? Just remember this from toxic substances, to make it simple. Obviously, we also have a suprachiasmatic nucleus, which is responsible for aligning internal clock and external clock, okay? And you can manipulate sleep by introducing light or introducing melatonin at certain timing in relationship to core body temperature. And this graph actually looks like complex, but what it shows you is this is a delay or advance of your sleep-wake cycle. So it shows you how intervention with melatonin or exposure to light can advance or delay sleep-wake cycle. For example, here you see this dim light melatonin onset. It's a time when you dim the light and first melatonin release start happening. Okay, and that's how it's called in literature, DLMO, dim light melatonin onset. So in other words, if you introduce melatonin before that, before that dim light, you will be able to advance the person. And if you do it after that, you will delay. Okay, if you introduce, for example, this is a temperature and exposure to light before minimum core body temperature and after. So if you introduce light before minimum core body temperature, which is about 2 hours prior to waking up. So here you see it's about 6 a.m. given that patient wakes up or person wakes up at 8. So you will be able to delay more circadian cycle. If you introduce it right after core body temperature, you will advance the person. So in other words, person will get more tired, sleepy, and will seek to go to bed early. So they will advance it. Okay. The only also this specific experiment shows you here that you see this sleep time, so it was sleep, and light was introduced to different, they call it light pulse, was introduced during different times in accordance to that initial sleep onset. So this is sleep onset, this is end of the sleep, and you see that when light was introduced beginning of sleep onset, habitual sleep onset, you see it started shifting. That is shifting sleep onset in this patient, like B and C, if it was introduced again before minimum core body temperature, it was shifting even more. But when you start to introduce it after core body temperature, you see it's advancing sleep onset. Okay, and this is what it shows, advancing sleep onset. And it's doing it also if you, again, in other words, if you introduce light around 6 p.m. and if you naturally wake up at 7 a.m., it will make you feel, you know, go to bed earlier, okay, following day, okay? That's what pretty much it shows. And also, you can, by introducing light to the beginning of sleep onset and in delayed fashion, you also can achieve so-called free-running cycle. So if you introduce light more and more and more, you can, like in blind people, that's what you see, they start shifting like 30 minutes in delayed fashion throughout this, like from day one to day 45, so there will be a marching sleep onset. So it's called non-24-hour cycle or running, free-running cycle. Usually happen in blind people or people who are detached from environment. Okay? So in other words, if you have patient in dark room, let's say it's ICU, and you decide to keep patient for 10 days, you will start seeing that they will start having delayed sleep phase. Okay, let's see how we do on time. Yeah, we're good. So I will put a couple of, we'll talk a little bit about normal physiologic changes during sleep. That way you can get a feel of things and physiologic functioning during that time. So interestingly that core body temperature peaks late in the day and declines before sleep onset and becomes nadir of core body temperature is 2-3 hours prior to usual rise time. And interestingly, that we still inherited that poikilothermia during REM sleep. In other words, when human body enters REM sleep, we absolutely lose ability to sustain temperature and assume temperature around us. That's why you can remember using blanket, especially in the morning, maybe sometimes waking up freezing, because this is what exactly happened, that the longest REM sleep happens in the morning, longest one period of REM sleep. And if it happens that environment is cold, we start cooling down. So respirations, voluntary control of respiration is obviously lost, and the responses to respiratory physiologic stressors would be reduced. Here, some parameters on minute ventilation, respiratory rate, CO2, O2, hypercapnic ventilatory response, hypoxic ventilatory response, and waking stage, slow wave sleep, and REM sleep. And you see that REM sleep is most vulnerable sleep. Also, cardiovascular changes in non-REM sleep. It's mostly stable sleep, slow wave sleep. We all know about that. But REM sleep, it's more chaotic, more unpredictable. And now we know that tonic REM and phasic REM also can, especially tonic REM, can produce bradyarrhythmias and sinus pauses. And phasic REM will be a lot of bursts of sympathetic tone and fluctuation heart rate and blood pressure. Gastrointestinal, obviously, it's also everything calms down. Esophageal motility will be reduced, swallowing saliva production will decrease, so people can have dry mouth. And gastric acid or acidity of gastric content will increase early during early hours between 11 p.m. and 2 a.m. Endocrine. The most remarkable things, of course, related to growth hormone, especially in kids and stage 3, growth hormone releases, and also prolactin picks up during slow wave sleep, and it's also pressed during sleep deprivation. Cortisol, we will have the lowest lowest points during sleep, and in early morning it will reach it will rise, and by awakening it would be probably highest level. So TSH changes also observed, and interestingly that it inhibited. TSH is inhibited by N3-stage and increases with sleep deprivation. So I'm introducing that sleep deprivation. Let's briefly talk about neurophysiological correlates. So we do sleep staging according to manual we have, and manual is right now very standardized, introducing methodological approaches. So what we do, we recognize patterns. And we get information from EEG, chin EMG, electroocullography, eye movements, and classically we're using a 30-second page epoch. And we have stages, 5 stages, wake and 1 and 2 and 3. It's non-REM sleep, 1, 2, 3, and the REM sleep is only one stage. Now it's called R stage. So the distribution in normal young adult, healthy adult, would be N1 5%, N2 about 50%, and N3 and REM, it's about 20-25%. So EEG, you all know that it's a collective records collective bioelectrical signal from the brain. Obviously, you can record now from each single neuron, but you need to really put electrodes under the dura, and it can be done. Dr. Romero knows from EMU evaluations, and but here, what you can do, you can just have not very precise, but preliminary evaluation of EEG patterns from frontal, from central and occipital regions of the brain. And usually, wake, we all know it's high frequency, low amplitude, chaotic waveforms, beta forms, and alpha if you close eyes. And after that, EEG start slowing down. And REM actually looks like wake, but what happens during REM that, human being will lose all tone and only rapid eye movements and will be happening, and also breathing will be sustained by diaphragm support. So some examples of sleep staging: awake, drowsy, stage 1, 2, 3, you will see theta waves, and you see that overall there is slowing in frequency of waveform, like delta sleep, it's 0.5 to 2 cycles per second. And REM, it's very close looking to, I would say, wake, but you will start seeing sawtooth waves, and also you will see that there is a paralysis. Yes?
Just a question in terms of the EEG versus the EMG, or I'm sorry, MEG, magnetoencephalography,
yes.
Sort of being like the difference between a plain film and a CT scan for the
yes.
brain. Are these same parameters defined with MEG?
Well, we're routinely not using magnetoencephalography for this specific. It's usually used for localization of epileptic focuses and in conjunction, like workup for epilepsy, especially focal epilepsy. Here we rely mostly on neurophysiologic correlates, okay, and mainly wave recognition would be. Now actually, auto scoring equipment or software started. Available, but it's still not exactly matching. It's not exactly matching the tech who would be professionally trained to score and stage different stages of sleep. And this is an example of one of the hypnograms. So that's what we see after we score and stage. You see this wake stage REM. We'll see reflected, and this is different stages 1, 2, and 3. Used to have 4 stage, but now it's 3 only. So you will be able to see that throughout the sleep, the initial REM will come in 90 minutes after sleep onset. And after that, every 90 minutes, 120 minutes, it will be coming back in conjunction with other stages of sleep, given that it's not interrupted. So this is normally looking sleep. So you see that I was talking about the last REM, which happens around between 6 and 7. So this is usually the longest one and deepest REM, so-called, which gives more refreshment. Here we wake up with dreaming and remembering those dreams. But at the same time, our temperature drops here. Remember, we touched on that. So consequences of sleep deprivation: mood changes, irritability, difficulty, concentration, hallucinations, elevation in evening cortisol, increased sympathetic activation, decreased thyrotropin activity, glucose tolerance. So there are a lot of metabolic changes which can increase long-term risk of cardiovascular events and mortality. For example, shorter sleep duration predicts susceptibility to catching cold. It was study in 2009, which showed that those folks who had less than 7 hours of night, they had, despite the given vaccination, they would have flu. Also, sleep deprivation is a pro-inflammatory condition, and it was studied. World Health Organization provided research on cancer, which showed that rotating shift work, and they supported it officially, it's a group 2A cancerogen. Okay, we're not talking about it much, but this is true. So same as the category UVB, radiation or HHV papilloma virus. So it's a real thing, and it affects our metabolic status, endocrine status, immune status, and autoimmunity, obviously. It also, what happens that sleep deprivation alerts CNS serotonin system and the genus opioid mechanism. So sleep loss will increase sensitivity to pain and increase subjective sense of suffering. And we know these descriptions of people who had acute sleep deprivation for more than 3 days, they would experience extreme suffering, psychological suffering. And all of that would be eliminated after they will take sleep, 8 hours of sleep, appropriate amount. So increased pain can cause obvious sleep disruption, and vicious cycle can start. So this is one of those studies also on small animals, on mice, show that if you advance the animal in their sleep, it will pretty much cause them to die. So they would advance in the shifting. It was delaying circadian cycle or advancing, and those animals which were advanced, they died faster than controls. You see this here. So also we know that if you deprived animal, mouse, specifically 2 weeks of sleep, they will die. And they will die from peritonitis. They will die from infection. So that's actually one of those experiments which supported that sleep deprivation can be dangerous. So general truths about sleep, let's talk about it. Sleep usually enter it through non-REM sleep. Again, non-REM and REM alternate. We discuss it every 90 minutes. Slow wave sleep will predominate first half of night, and REM predominance will go to last half of the night. And all of that will be like REM sleep, for example, peaks at core body temperature minimum at last cycle. Sleep deprivation and delirium. So most ICU patients will experience sleep deprivation and delirium, and obviously elderly, previously demented, mechanically ventilated, most at risk for delirium. And delirium is independently associated with mortality, increased cost, and length of stay, and long-term cognitive impairment. There is so far no data which can directly establish a relationship for ICU patients between sleep deprivation and delirium. But obviously, these conditions are important to recognize, and it will help you. I consider it to be the risk factor, so it's important to recognize it and address it. So challenges to studying sleep in ICU. Obviously, sleep measurements in critically ill patients important barrier to large studies in ICU. So that's why we don't see a lot of large studies recently. There was a couple of reviews dedicated to that, and I'm going to show you a little bit data from that. So polysomnography also difficult to do for ICU patients, but we have methodology right now with portable studies. Actigraphy can be potentially done. And this assessment tool, Richard Campbell Sleep Questionnaire, was listed in those studies and was validated. Just to show you examples of patients in ICU, so you see how fragmented sleep of this patient. Patient 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So they did not get any solid, consolidated sleep. They all were disrupted. So Let's learn how to address those potential sources of sleep deprivation, how you can clinically do it. Yes.
This is just maybe a really but how do we know? So we've got the patient intubated.
Yes.
They've got multiple rib fractures. They've got an open abdomen. They're going to be intubated. They may have an element of head injury. How do we know if they're sleeping? How does, say, propofol versus a benzodiazepine versus Presidex, you know, how do those things either facilitate or maybe inhibit our ability to get us?
There is no, rhythm? Yeah, you're absolutely right, because so many factors exist in ICU, right? And also, not only ICU, the specific trauma, I can see that different trauma can produce different disturbances, which can potentially respond positively or negatively to those interventions like intubation or pain management or specifically other things. That's a big challenge. I would say to you it's a big challenge. And that's why when I started, I specifically said that this is a young field. A lot of things are not established, and a lot of things are only can be explored. We still have a lot of things to explore. So the what I can propose for our trauma team that maybe it's a good idea for us to establish systematic methodology which we can use for each and single patient, or look for those things in each and single patient, and try to objectively understand what can disturb sleep, what can facilitate sleep, and how it can improve it, okay? So five-finger approach, actually, which was developed by Dr. McCarthy, this is one of those tools, okay? So it addresses circadian misalignment, pharmacological factors, medical factors, psychiatric, psychosocial factors, primary sleep diagnosis. So if you use this and keep it in your mind, you can... We're utilizing it in our practice every day. I think it's an easy tool to remember, easy tool to cut through any specific case of patient with presumed sleep complaint or who actively complaining on any sleep disturbances, difficulty falling asleep, staying asleep, or having sleepiness during daytime. So let's explore it. So. Sample of outpatient diagnosis from each of five domains. It's outpatient, but here what can be done here, again, circadian misalignment, delayed sleep phase syndrome. I kind of spent time to explain it. It really depends on physiology, circadian physiology and process S, process C. And if you're able to apply it, you will be able to prevent those delayed sleep phase syndrome, especially manipulation with melatonin and light exposure. Okay, pharmacologic factors, insomnia due to drug or substance, hypersomnia due to drug or substance, potentially. Medical factors, it could be, let's say, insomnia, hypersomnia due to medical problems. For example, chronic pain, very frequent, I see and can picture a patient with trauma experiencing that. It's a significant high degree severe pain. Psychosocial, psycho-environmental factors, insomnia due to mental disorder like PTSD, generalized anxiety disorder, stress or depression experienced by the patient, repetitive environmental sleep disturbances, light, noise, patient care, activities, procedures, discomfort from non-invasive ventilation, mechanical ventilation, those things. And here we also can address primary sleep diagnosis, obstructive sleep apnea, restless legs, narcolepsy, etc. So one patient can have it all. All these factors can play the role in disturbing sleep. So if you think about your specific patient and use this methodic tool, you will probably be able to address it one at a time fashion. All right, well, let's explore these causes of sleep disruption in ICU. So circadian misalignment, again, light suppresses melatonin secretion, can alert circadian sleep phase. Daytime sleep impairs homeostatic sleep drive and promotes nocturnal wakefulness. And potential solutions here, obviously, we can maximize environmental exposure to light during morning and midnight time frames, encourage behavioral interventions, cognitive stimulation to promote wakefulness during the day, and minimize environmental light during nocturnal time frame. So in other words, we need to make sure that patient feels attachment with environment, and the regular all mammals born in, on the earth, they pretty much attach to light or darkness one way or other way. Okay, human beings usually function during daytime we on, during nighttime we off, so our circadian clock is built that way. So if we help patients to stay attached, I think it's one of the most potent preventive measures for delirium, because especially in elderly, because if you're able to familiarize them with environment, it pretty much keeps them anchored. Pharmacological influences, pressors, beta agonists, nebulizers, steroids, antiarrhythmics can be potentially causing insomnia. Benzos, long-term users will suffer potential rebound insomnia. So in other words, you need to make sure those medications continued, because if they get abrupt withdrawal, that's what you will get. Opiate usually suppresses REM and slow wave sleep and can promote nocturnal awakenings and cause central apnea as well. And also benzos, anticholinergics can be associated with delirium in ICU patients, even at low doses. So potential solutions, we need to optimize medical management. Try to avoid anticholinergic benzos and opiates to manage insomnia. You can consider benzodiazepine receptor agonists or specific hypnotics to manage insomnia if it's not the symptom of insomnia, but it's true insomnia. That's what we're talking about. But otherwise, you need to be very careful with these medications. Also, pain is one of the medical conditions. It will be finger three medical conditions. So this is probably going to be the most powerful factor which will disrupt the patient and trauma for sure. So other things, of course, other comorbidities, COPD, CHF, cancer can worsen that. And here the challenge would be to optimize pain management. And here you have anesthesia initially, anesthetics, which can do it if patient is intubated specifically. After that, when patient is extubated, it needs to be monitored and addressed. In terms of social, psychiatric, environmental factors, noise, light, those things which typically treatment-related environment like blood draws, radiology, vital signs, mechanical ventilation, non-invasive ventilation, fear and anxiety, the patient is lonely without his relatives, significant others, and trying to understand what's going on. So all of that can potentially be a source for delirium. So for noise, specifically a psychoenvironmental factor, finger four or domain four, staff conversations, overhead paging, telephone, TV equipment, all of that, remember, can produce noise. And of course, in ICU, peak noise is routinely 80 decibels, and you see that it's above recommended noise for general population. PSG recordings in ICU patients attribute up to 25% of awakenings arousals to noise. Potentially, a solution can be quiet hours, reduce, eliminate overhead pages, or culture change in this specific. And this is an example of PSG. So you see this EEG recording, and suddenly noise appears here, noise spike, and you see it produced fastening in EEG, which we call arousal or incomplete awakening. So that's what was happening here. So we see that EEG was running slow, and suddenly, because of that noise spike, it fastened and interrupted and disrupted sleep, causing sleep fragmentation. Patient key activity, ICU patients may experience about 40 to 60 interruptions each night due to patient care. Those who actually been a patient maybe remember this. I have that experience, and it's, you know, it's life, and what can we do? Obviously, we need to just make sure that rooms are insulated and also alarms quieted, so patients kind of separated from that noise. And also consolidation of patient key activity, maybe it's good to do it in one bulk instead of, you know, just doing it in a fragmented way. Visitation times, we're obviously doing it, bathing time and other activities time. Light, we talked about light being chronobiotic factor, so it can move hours and affect our circadian cycle, but also light levels were studied, and it takes about 100 to 500 lux to suppress melatonin. And you see that indoor lights are above that level, obviously, thanks to Mr. Edison. He wanted us to read, he wanted us to function, right? So we cannot blame him for that. It changed our life dramatically in a positive way. But again, if you are assuming and want patient to sleep, you need to create environment for patient or for anybody. So ICU survivors report light is less disruptive than noise in patient care. So noises was considered to be the most important. Mechanical ventilation also can cause sleep fragmentation, reduce sleep efficiency, increase daytime sleep, disrupting circadian cycle. So contributing factors, increased ventilator effort, abnormal gas exchange, and desynchrony. So vent desynchrony actually was one of those factors which were reported. Proportional assist ventilation compared with pressure support ventilation improved patient ventilatory synchrony, tidal volume, and decreased sleep arousals, helped with consolidating sleep. So it was one of the studies in 2007 which supported that. Fear and anxiety, obviously, big factor. Many patients admitted ICU should be treated for generalized anxiety disorder, and it needs to be addressed if they can communicate. Non-pharmacological interventions, and also involvement of family can help to conquer anxiety. So this is one of the articles was recently published, 2015. Addressing these environmental factors causing sleep deprivation, and also pathophysiological factors, pain, psychosis, inflammatory responses, organ stress. But to address it, I think if you would utilize five-finger approach, it will help you clinically very quickly push right buttons. And if you address it one at a time, you specifically would be able to improve patient sleep. And environment means a lot. Environment means a lot. Okay. So primary sleep diagnosis, snoring in obstructive sleep apnea. We know that hypertensive urgency, CVA, acute coronary syndrome, CHF, all, you know, can cause OSA. And I will show you chart. Narcolepsy. Interestingly, narcolepsy with cataplexy. Maybe that was a cause of car accident. Okay. With obstructive sleep apnea, we had several patients. I was consulted who had car accident with uncontrolled obstructive sleep apnea. We were very sleepy. They were sleepy, and they had car accident because they fall asleep 3 seconds, and that was enough for them with speed of 60 miles per hour to hit something. So restless leg syndrome. Obviously, it also can be in patients who have iron deficiency, anemia, antiemetic medications, antipsychotic medications. Those are provocative elements, so patient can really... A potential solution would be screen and pay attention to past medical history. And obviously, I will show you the tool, Stop Pain tool, which is already incorporated in our Epic system. We're using it for stroke patients. Every stroke patient is screened. That's our goal, actually. We're working hard to do it, right? So here you see consequences of obstructive sleep apnea. You see stroke, hypertension, coronary artery disease, cardiac arrhythmias, congestive heart, and failure, for example, or neurocognitive impairment, mood disturbance, depression, sleep, loud snoring, obesity, GERD. All of this can be potentially consequences. So that's what we're doing. We're using that Stop Pain questionnaire. If you have snoring, diet, observed blood pressure treatment, or have blood pressure while treatment, BMI more than 35, age more than 15, neck circumference more than 16 inches, gender male, so more than 3 will put you at high risk for this probability of obstructive sleep apnea, high risk of having mild to severe obstructive sleep apnea. If Stop Pain questionnaire more than 5, you have patient, you will have high risk of having moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea. Okay, so it's more specific. One more thing I want to show here. The study was done in Johns Hopkins School of Medicine in 2012. The doctors tried to explore what would be the best pattern for in ICU for the team to prevent those things we discussed above. So they did study over a year period, actually 2 years, from February, March, April, May. So they were running it between February 2009 to June 2010. You see that all these months. And they applied different strategies, okay? First strategy was baseline, so no intervention. They just did sleep survey. It was Press Ganey noise recording, so it's a scale which to asking patient to rate the noise level specifically specific times. And they run it like an average operation baseline for four months. So after that, for 4 months, they did phase two. They did basic sleep rounds. They did checklist. We will show you the checklist. Yes, was a question? Somebody want? Oh, okay. Sleep survey, and they did sleep survey during the time noise recording. After that, they did washout for about 6 months, and after that, they did deluxe sleep rounds. Okay, so let's give you a little bit more information here. So basically, sleep rounds checklist. That's what they did. They instructed every nurse there to exactly go by standard questionnaire. In other words, communication will go this way. Good night. I'm a member of sleep squad. I'm here to do the nightly sleep rounds. It's now bedtime. Would you like to go to the bathroom? So in other words, they consolidated all this care, patient care things in one survey and addressed all TV noise, turn off light. They offered to turn off light. And in other words, they followed that with each and every patient during that period. Deluxe sleep rounds, it was this basics, and plus they were giving people amenities. So they were giving pillows, they were giving hot beverage, they were giving some lotion to people, thinking that it will help them to, like with, you know, hotel kind of hospitality. So now what we got? We got some data back. So that was a survey, and the results of the survey was such that if you look here, first question, how much difficulty did you have sleeping last night? So at baseline, they rate it as a mild, 3, it's mild. For during basic sleep rounds, they rate it as a little, 2, and 4, and washout, for some reason, 4. They give washout period, so no intervention again was done, but for some reason, they thought it was moderate, okay? And during the lux, it was higher than at basic. So it was also, I mean, they said it was mild, but it still was higher than and basic sleep rounds. Second question, how many hours did you sleep last night? At baseline, patients reported 6 hours, basic rounds 6 hours, washout period 5 hours, and deluxe 5 hours. So it was more hours of sleep during during basic rounds. How many times did you wake up during the night while you were trying to sleep? They reported 3 times in baseline, 3 times in basic rounds, deluxe 3 times, and washout for some reason was higher. How long did you take to go to sleep last night? So it was 16, 20 minutes at baseline, 0 to 10 minutes, which is very close to normal, like we have in basic, 11 to 15 minutes in washout, and 11, 15 minutes a little bit longer in deluxe. So this is also same data representing. So it shows that these basic sleep rounds really work better than deluxe ones. Okay, that if you look here, number of minutes to go to sleep was shorter, and difficulty falling asleep was less complaints. So, and they also did this score reporting the noise around the room. So 90 is the highest. The score goes from 0 to 99, so 99 highest. This is the lowest. These are months, which they were checking it. Subjective report, and this is dotted line represent average national score. So you see that baseline actually started not too bad, but it was some month in April when they got a lot of above national level. During basic, it was also first month it was okay, but after that they reported high. Washout period, for some reason, you remember that they slept. They took them longer to fall asleep. A number of waking is high a little bit, but overall noise was lower. And deluxe was a lot of noise too. Only 2 months were kind of positively going under very less noisy, so it was more quiet. So let's recap. How we can make our ICU sleep friendly? Obviously, if we develop methodology and we develop the right clinical way to address this issue, I think, and be sensitive, we can obviously take the equation that sleep is a vital biological process. It has to happen, and it needs to be arranged for the patient. And sleep deprivation can cause adverse physiological and psychological consequences. Interventions to improve quality of sleep in ICU patients require balancing and the competing goals. So we need to make sure we take care of the patient, but at the same time, patient would be able to rest in between those procedures. Also, one of the suggested intervention, again, light alteration, noise reduction, melatonin administration, illness characteristics. So can address those factors, which we recently published in Journal of Critical Care. Again, they did not put it in the way that we're using here, but I think, again, if you put your 5 domains, you will quickly come to this this similar chart and understand how we can do it. I mean, maybe developing similar chart and incorporating the in the rounds and trying to address it right for each patient, maybe that's a good idea too. So again, summary, the sleep-friendly ICU avoids disturbances in all 5 domains of clinical sleep medicine, if possible, circadian misalignment, bright light during the day, darkness at night, behavioral interventions to promote daytime wakefulness, positioning, early mobilization, cognitive stimulation, pharmacological factors, avoid delirium. To avoid delirium, use benzos for anxiety, opiates for pain at lowest effective dose, but please don't use them for sedation or hypnotic effect. Avoid anticholinergics as hypnotics. consider use benzorreceptor agonist if hypnotic is needed. So, but I would say that if you come to this point, please, you know, maybe request sleep medicine consult and or curbside us. We can discuss overall need for that. Those insomniogenics in the morning, if possible, so in other words, stimulating, alerting medications should be given in the morning, so that way you will promote wakefulness. And be vigilant for withdrawal insomnia in patients who chronically take benzos as outpatient, because these guys actually can really give trouble. Medical factors address pain, optimize medical management of insomnia provoking medical problems, consider judicious use of hypnotics for residual sleep disruptions caused by medical problems under optimal management. Psychosocial, psychiatric, environmental factors, they need to be addressed. We need to reduce ICU noise because it's mostly a reported factor. During nocturnal hours, pages, TV, conversations, non-essential monitoring equipment, noisy procedures. Maybe earplug use or white noise use may decrease environmental sleep disturbances, optimize patient ventilator synchrony, consolidate patient care activities whenever possible, recognize and address anxiety, could be non-pharmacological measures or pharmacological measures, low dose benzos, primary sleep diagnosis, recognize importance of primary sleep diagnosis and screening for them. We say RLS primary hypersomnias. And if patient already had medications on board or CPAP machine or other devices we give for sleep related issues, continue that, because usually we provide everything in the chart. And this is concludes our presentation. Any questions? I try to go fast, sorry for that. Yeah, I'm a little bit over time, I'm sorry. Okay, thank you very much. Yes, yes, doctor.
You know, I do think that this is a field that's ripe for study.
Oh, yes.
That, you know, it's to get published, you either got to be smarter than everybody else or pick something that nobody else is doing. And there's really not very much of this in trauma, and yet, trauma is probably going to be one of the biggest offenders. And even studying trauma surgeons, in the Harvard longitudinal study, they looked at nurses and found that as little as 3 months of night shifts increased the rate of breast cancer. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the question then becomes, well, what about people?
Yeah, that data came from World Health Organization. They used that study.
So
it came from that study.
It's, there's suicides in trauma surgeons. There's all the things that are the adverse effects. While firefighters have learned to push, moving their wakeful or their start time back. Mm-hmm. So every day they get, or not every day, but every shift when they change an hour to sleep later to cover the night. We haven't done that. We just...
Well, I would say that restoration after shift and specifically shift scheduling, I mean, if you're talking about medical personnel, I think we can... try to establish some research in that area, because we need to make sure that every human being will get restoration after you get hard shift. In other words, maybe, I mean, we know from sleep deprivation, you need to have at least 2 full nights, normal 8 hours sleep arranged, okay?
For one, yes.
To pick up for one acute sleep deprivation episode, which is shift, translated to shift, right? Because if you stay overnight 30 hours, awakening for 30 hours means acute sleep deprivation. So in experiments, it was shown that needs to two nights, uninterrupted nights, to just restore the function. So I think what needs to happen, it needs to be same like for we do for CDL, commercial driver's license, checking in for pilots. I think the rules like for pilots should be established for physicians. And they need to be exactly followed. Because if we, I mean, we can push ourselves, obviously, but we need to understand that there are consequences really on the level of, I mean, we did not touch today like safer or alertness and fatigue management, which we can do maybe later on, like because I did, last year I did grand round for surgeons. So it's one thing, but obviously patient, being patient, it's also involves understanding of management is, you know. And a lot of things come from environment. Based on the literature I looked, a lot of things come from environment. If, in other words, the environment is consolidated and those things addressed, patient feels much more comfortable. But again, it's not always possible. It depends on the...
Would it be to set up EEGs in the SICU for trauma patients and just run some studies to look at, you know, what's going on with them? Has that been done in trauma patients using EEGs
no.
to determine?
Well, what can be done actually? There are several ways. There are observational way of doing things, right? Because obviously actigraphy probably will not show much here because patient is sedated. Maybe intubated, maybe. What we can do, we can, of course, do observations. So in other words, let's say every hour patient is observed and it's I mean, they record it anyway, if patient is sleeping or not, but if patient is sedated, obviously we can already address that. Yes, so we cannot.
Yeah. Is to see if they're...
An objective would be, yes, you using EEG, using maybe some limited sleep study or portable sleep study to look if what's happening to sleep. I mean, no, it was not done. We can do it. We can do it. We can see specifically what would be interesting to see the different injuries, how they correlate with sleep disturbance. And I mean, given that we provide same environment for all patients. In other words, you will have like schedule, everything on schedule there.
Right. I mean, now the SICU has curtains. So the idea of insulating the room is comical.
Yes.
You have a curtain between
patients. Plugs, remember. Plugs, they were using ear plugs for some of the patients. So we might...
ear plugs, something over their eyes, because you can't block the light, you can't block the noise with a curtain.
Well, it could be assumed during, let's say, if you want to regulate sleep-wake cycle, so at night time you can put those air plugs when it's supposed to be air plugs, and then you feel that, you know, yes, patient wants to sleep, and in the morning they need to be taken out, and you need to make sure that cognitive stimulation is provided. I mean, a lot of things we can plan here. It's open field. That's what's beautiful about this, because now we have methodology, we can technically apply it in the way we want and design those studies, and we can do everything we want.
That's great.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Welcome. Thank you. Yes.